They were drifting in the darkness. The sea was all around. They cried out to the master. He saved us or we'll drown. Jesus heard the cries, and mercy stilled the wind. Sometimes it takes a storm to see the sun. Sometimes it takes a storm to know you need a shelter. When the anchor's in your life, disappear without a trace. Sometimes the wind will rage before you sail calm waters. Sometimes it takes a storm to find a hiding. Sometimes the wind will rage before you sail calm waters. Lord, thank you for the storms, for I found my hiding. Oh, thank you for the storms. Lord, you are my hiding place.
Mr. Perry, you're muted. Pastor Barry, you are muted. You have to unmute yourself.
We hope, first of all, again, I want to say welcome to another Mighty Angels Ministries broadcast. And we want to, first of all, say to all of you, happy Sabbath. And we hope that you'll be blessed by the study of God's word, because that is the ultimate aim, that you will be able to go back and study these things out for yourselves. Because the Bible said in Acts 17:11, these were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word already some mind and searched the scriptures daily, whether those things were so. So it's very important that we take time to do what? Search the scriptures. So I want to make that point clear to us as we will study God's word together. Now, the other thing I want to tell you is, as we go through this for just a moment, is that we're going to have a, there will be no meeting on tomorrow afternoon because I have to do a communion service. So we're going to let everybody know that. Please keep us in prayer as we will do the communion service for this this little church here in this area for the last year of the year, for the last Sabbath in this year. Brothers and sisters, God has been good to us so far, and he has allowed all of us so far to live to see another year. We know the new year is coming, but, you know, only a few days away. But brothers and sisters, we know that this year will be a year of turmoil. And especially in America with the elections and everything else, it's a year where they want to bring about the image of the beast by bringing in a conservative party for president. Brothers and sisters, only God can hold back the winds that are about to blow. And we need to be watching and praying every step of the way, plus making preparations as much as we can to be out of arm's way when the cities and different things are becoming more and more infested with crime, violence, and vice of all types. So we need to be praying for that. Meanwhile, I also want to say to you all this evening, it's good to be here, and Lord blessed us to get back to the other area of Ecuador, South America, where we are broadcasting from today. So we thank God for that. It was a 10-hour journey, so 12-hour journey, actually. So the Lord has been good to us. So, and we also thank God because they have the power out, and we were praying that the power would be cut off, and then it will be cut back on just prior to the broadcast. And that's exactly what happened tonight so far. So we know that the Holy Spirit is with us as we are going with this broadcast tonight. Now, we're going to have a word of prayer. Then we're going to have our song of meditation. And after that song of meditation, we're going to come back and we're going to study seduce my servants and commit fornication. And we're going to take a look at that real close from the word of God. All right. From the word. And also we'll be looking at it from some historical standpoints as well. All right. With that thought in mind, let's have a word of prayer again. Father in heaven, we bow before thee again, thanking thee for this, your holy Sabbath day. We ask that you will help us enter into rest with thee, for we know it's not by might, nor is it by power, but it's by your spirit. We address our prayer to the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, where Jesus is our great high priest, where the final work of atonement is now taking place. We thank you for the atoning sacrifice that was made on the cross of Calvary, and for the atonement that's now being conducted by our great high priest, the Lord Jesus Christ, in the cleansing of the sanctuary and the putting away of sin through the sacrifice of himself. Father, we ask thee, please, help us be partakers of the divine nature and escape the corruptions that are in this world through lust. Give us understanding of the scriptures and help us rightly divide the word of truth. Now, please grant us thy Holy Spirit for early rain and in preparation to receive latter rain. We ask this all in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. At this time, we're going to have our song of meditation. Miss my turn.
There he was just waiting in our old familiar place, an empty spot beside him where I once used to wait, to be filled with strength and wisdom for the battles of the day. I would have passed him by again, but I clearly heard him say, I miss my time with you, those moments together. I need to be with you each day, and it hurts me when you say you're too busy, busy trying to serve me. But how can you serve me when your spirit is empty? There's a longing in my heart, wanting more than just a part of you. It's true. I miss my time with you. What will I have to offer? How can he truly care? My efforts have no meaning when your presence isn't there. But you'll provide the power if I'll take the time to pray. I stay right here beside you, and you'll never have to say, I miss my time with you, those moments together. I need to be with you each day, and it hurts me when you say you're too busy, busy trying to serve me. But how can you serve me when your spirit is empty? There's a longing in my heart, wanting more than just a part of you. It's true. I miss my time with you.
As we look at this issue that we are facing in our world today, and as we look at the issues that are facing God's people, We all need to be in a very serious mood of watching and praying as we're preparing to go into a new year. We are watching things that are unprecedented in the history of Adventism. And also, it seems as though the things that are unprecedented in the history of Adventism is also parallel with the events that are unprecedented that's taking place in the world. But all of them are signs showing us that Jesus is about to come. Brothers and sisters, if there was ever a time, again, I keep emphasizing again and again, that we need to prepare ourselves for Christ's return, that time is now. Never in the history of the world have we seen the things that we're watching today. Never. But at the same time, I just want to bring one thing to your attention as we do this. Could we just do one thing right quick? I just want everybody to, could you play one more special music for a moment? I have to do something very important, but just a moment. Could you just play another song just for a few moments? Hold on one second. Yeah.
Not in wandering, but in praying.
Thank you so much for your patience on that. Our power just had came back on, and we had just had ate dinner. So I just wanted to thank you so much for your patience. Now, at this time, I'd like for you to look back with me as we're looking back at Revelation chapter 2, verses 19 and 20. It says, I know thy works and the charity and thy service. We're dealing with the church of Thyatira. And our title tonight is seducing servants and committing fornication. The Bible says, I know thy works and thy charity and thy service and faith and thy patience and thy works, the last to be more than the first. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed to idols. Now, brothers and sisters, we're going to take a look at this in the times of Jezebel and Elijah. And we're going to look at this in bringing up to our time where we are today. But we are watching this history repeat itself right before our very eyes. And if there was a time when you and I need to really look at these things carefully and really examine, that time is now, while we have opportunity to even study the Word of God. So let us take a look from the scriptures at this matter. We're going to start off here, looking here at verse 20. Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou suffered that woman Jezebel. Now let's break it down from Bible prophecy first. Then we will go into the history and we'll read some things from different materials that we have on Daniel Revelation. But right now, let's go to the scriptures. First of all, the Bible says here, that woman, Jezebel, a woman in scripture, in prophetic scriptures, symbolizes a church. I'd like for somebody to read for us Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 2, and Isaiah 51, 16. Jeremiah 6, verse 2, and Isaiah 51, 16. In Jeremiah 6, 2, the Bible says, I have likened the daughter of Zion unto a comely and delicate woman. Notice the daughter of Zion represents what? A comely and delicate woman. And then the Bible tells us over in Isaiah 51, 16, I have put my words in thy mouth and have covered thee with the shadow of my hand, that I may plant the heavens and lay the foundation of the earth and say unto Zion, thou art my people. So in the Old Testament, we see from these two scriptures that Zion, the daughter of Zion, represents God's people. What about in the New Testament? In the New Testament, a woman is still represented as a church. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 2, the Paul put it this way, I have likened thee unto a comely and delicate woman. I didn't quote that right. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 11, 2, for I am jealous over thee with godly jealousy. For I have espoused unto you one husband, that I may present you as a what? Chaste virgin to Christ. So here we have a church that is represented as a woman, but is represented as a chaste virgin. This chaste virgin church is represented also in the book of Revelation, and Revelation chapter 12, looking at verse 1. Go with me to Revelation chapter 12, and let's look at verse 1. We're going to go to our PowerPoint in a little bit, so hold on. Revelation 12, verse 1. And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. Now, the reason why I'm going over this is because recently this week, there was a person that was a very knowledgeable Catholic historian, and they were breaking down the history of things that have been taking place. And much of what this woman said was true. But when it came down to the interpretation of Revelation, she interpreted that woman of Revelation chapter 12 as Mary. Now, why is that important to us? Because that woman of Revelation 12 is not Mary. That woman of Revelation 12 represents God's church throughout the ages and coming down to the remnant church in these last days. A woman in Bible prophecy represents a church and is not representing the Catholic Church. It is representing God's church throughout the history of the issues of the great controversy. Listen carefully. The woman is clothed. What does it mean for a church to be clothed? What would God clothe the woman or the church with? Go in your Bibles to Isaiah 61:10. Could somebody read Isaiah 61:10? Quickly.
Isaiah 61:10 says, "For I will greatly rejoice in the Lord. My soul shall be joyful in my God, for he hath clothed me with the garments of salvation. He hath covered me with the robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom decketh himself with ornaments, and as a bride adorneth herself with her jewels."
Notice that the woman representing God's church is clothed with what? Salvation, and with what? Righteousness. Did everybody see that there? The woman's clothed with salvation and righteousness. Mm-hmm. And what is this salvation the woman's clothed with and righteousness clothed with? It's the gospel. Go with me to Romans 1:16 and 17. Let's see. The woman is clothed with salvation and righteousness, which is symbols of the gospel. She's clothed with the gospel of Jesus Christ, the woman of Revelation 12, which is represented as a chaste virgin. Go with me to Romans 1:16 and 17. Listen what Paul says here. Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, but it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as is written, the just shall live by faith." So here we find that the woman is clothed with salvation, meaning deliverance from sin. How do we know? Matthew 1:21 says what? "And she shall bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." Here the Bible shows very clearly that man will never be saved in sin. Man must be saved from sin, and the only one that can save man from sin is Jesus. He's the only one. That's why Jesus says in John 14:6, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come unto the Father but by me," because Jesus is the only way by which man can be delivered from sin. There's no other way for man to be delivered from sin. Regardless of what you might, what you've heard, or what some are trying to advocate, the only way man can be saved from sin is through the death, resurrection, and high priestly ministry of the Son of God.
Amen.
This is why we're Christ, the Son of God. Listen very carefully. Let's go a little bit closer, though. So the woman is clothed with the gospel, and the Bible says she's clothed with the Son. What is one of the major doctrines of the gospel that the woman will be advocating, this woman who's a chaste virgin? What will she be advocating? Look what the Bible says over in Malachi chapter 4, verse 2. Malachi 4, 2. Could somebody read that for us? In Malachi chapter 4, verse 2.
"But unto you that fear my name shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings, and ye shall go forth and grow up as calves of the stall."
Notice it says, "But unto you that what? Fear my name." Now, do you notice very carefully a condition is here? Those who fear God's name, they will experience the rising of the what? "Unto you that fear my name shall the Son of what? Righteousness arise with healing in his wings." Healing is introducing medical missionary work, believe it or not. And the Son of Righteousness is dealing with Christ's righteousness, brothers and sisters. Capital S-U-N here is talking about Christ and his righteousness. The righteousness of Christ that has healing in his wings. But righteousness is also connected to the scriptures and the commandments of God. How do we know? In 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, the Bible says, "All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. So the scriptures give instruction in what? Righteousness. The gospel is also the gospel of Jesus Christ, is the power of God unto salvation, for therein is the what? Righteousness of God revealed. And when Malachi 4:2 says, unto you that fear my name, shall the Son of righteousness arise with healing his wings. Righteousness, first and foremost, comes from God, and it comes also and is found also in the word of God, but it's also found in the commandments of God. In Psalms 119, 172, the Bible put it this way, my tongue shall speak of thy word, for all thy commandments are righteousness. So wait a minute, Son of righteousness is dealing with the character of Christ. Son of righteousness is also dealing with the word of God, and righteousness also deals with the law of God, brothers and sisters. So is it very important for us that we attain to the character of Christ, and also that we are standing on sound doctrines of the word of God, and that we are also keeping and seeking to keep all God's commandments. Brothers and sisters, this is represented by the church of Revelation chapter 12. She has the sun in her head, the sun, a symbol of Christ's righteousness, and she has the moon at her feet. The moon, what is the moon for? Did anybody remember? Go with me to Psalms 89. Psalms 89 for just a moment. We're going to make the contrast between these two women so you understand why this is so important for us to pay attention to tonight. In Psalms chapter 89, what did the Bible say the moon really is? In Psalms 89. This is what the Bible says here. In Psalms 89, looking at verse 37, because Psalms 89, 37. Could somebody read that for us?
Psalms 89, number 37. It shall be established forever as the moon and as a faithful witness in heaven. Selah.
Notice, what's the moon represent of? A what? A faithful witness. Or as the moon is a faithful witness. What is the moon a faithful witness of? If we look at history, we'll find that the moon is a faithful witness of God making it one of the lesser lights in creation. Remember that? He made two great lights, great lights, the lesser, greater light to rule the day, the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. Mm-hmm. The moon is a faithful witness, just like the sun is a faithful witness, that God created these things. There's no wires on the moon, and there's no wires holding up the sun. Mm-hmm. And at the same time, you said, well, they're held up by gravity, but who made the gravity? Because man didn't make it.
That's right. God did.
This is God. This is the work of the omnipotent God. Amen. And the Bible says that it's not even really upheld by gravity. It's upheld by all things upheld by the word of his power. It is his word that upholds all things. Look what the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, and looking here at verse 1 and 2. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. For by it the elders obtained a good report. Through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the what, everybody? By the word of God.
Word of God.
So that things that are seen are not made by things which do appear. So here the Bible says that even all the worlds out there that we see, from planets in our galaxy to unfallen worlds, all things are upheld by the word of God. Are y'all with me now? In Colossians chapter 1, verse 16, want to make it clear again. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16. Look what the Bible says again on this point. Could somebody read that for us? Colossians 1, 16 and 17. Colossians 1, 16 and 17.
For by him we are things created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created by him and for him, and he is before all things, and by him all things consist.
Notice Jesus is before all things. That's the him he's talking about. And by him, all things consist. So there's nothing that's existing in our universe There's nothing upholding the sun, moon, and stars but the word of God.
Mm-hmm.
Brothers and sisters, what a powerful testimony. And yet at the same time, this is the same word that you have right now in front of you. And it's the same word that had became incarnated and became flesh and died on the cross to save you from sin, to restore in you the image of God, and help you gain victory over sin, that your name can be retained in the book of life and one day receive immortality.
Amen.
This is the same word that's doing all those things. And so this same word is able to give us power to resist sin, put away idolatry, put away secret sins, and walk with God in righteousness and holiness and in the fear of God, out of love for him. Listen what the Bible goes on and tells us now. So we see that this woman in Revelation chapter 12 is a virtuous woman. She's a woman that has the word of God. She's a woman that has the commandments of God. She's a woman that has the character of Christ, and she carries with her the Son of Righteousness, Christ's righteousness. She's clothed in his garments. Brothers and sisters, and so let me make it plain again. This woman represents the same gospel, the same everlasting gospel that's in Revelation chapter 14. She has a remnant of her seed. The remnant of that woman's seed is the last remaining seed of the woman in these last days and is represented by God's people. We know that the remnant of her seed represents the Seventh-day Adventist church. And out of that remnant church, God will have a final remnant people that will be purified and made white through the blood of the Lamb. They will be purified and made white in the final issues as we're going through the final scenes of the cleansing of the sanctuary and the final scenes of Earth's history, prophetically speaking. Brothers and sisters, we are on the verge of Christ finishing his work in that most holy place, and it behooves us all to be sure that we're sending our prayers there by faith, and we're confessing our sins and sending them there by faith, that there be no sin found on us when Jesus shall finish or come to our name in this final scenes of investigative judgment in the cleansing of the sanctuary and for the blotting out of sin. So I want to make that plain to you. That's what we're dealing with. But now look a little closer with me now as we go a little bit more deeper. First of all, now let's look at this woman of Revelation. Let's go to Revelation 17 for a moment. Now we know that we have a virtuous woman in Revelation 12, but the woman of Revelation 17 is the same woman that started her church in the church of Thyatira. Brothers and sisters, notice very carefully what the Bible says, because somebody read Revelation, wait a minute, Revelation 17, follow me for a moment. In Revelation 17, 1 through 5, the Bible said, there came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials and spake with me, saying, and talked with me, saying, come hither, and I will show thee the judgment of the great what? Of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. First of all, the Bible called her a great whore. What does the Bible mean when it calls somebody, calls a church a whore? Why does God use such harsh terms? Is there a reason for this? Because God charged Israel in the Old Testament for practicing harlotry, all right? And at the same time, when had many lovers, the Bible says. So here we find that we have a church in the end time that is just like ancient Israel before, that went about going a-whoring. Another word for a whore is a strange woman. What does the Bible say about the whore or the strange woman? This is something that we need to take a look at for just a moment, because I want to make it plain to you that the servants of God are going to be seduced in the end time by this mystical yet spiritual Babylon that is represented by this woman. Before I go any further, let me finish reading that to you, and then we're going to do a little breakdown on this woman for just a moment from the scriptures. Look what the Bible says in verse 2. It says, with whom the kings of the earth have committed what? Fornication. Did we read that? Is that one of the issues in the church of Thyatira? That the church has committed fornication? That this woman is committing fornication? Listen very carefully. With the kings of the earth And it says, and have committed fornication with the inhabitants thereof, inhabitants of the earth, and have made them drunk with the wine of her fornication. Very interesting. So he carried me away in the spirit. And I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet colored beast, full of names and blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand, full of the abominations and filthiness of her fornication. Now, if we studied this carefully, we already saw early on that this woman, that the woman of Revelation 12 was a virtuous woman, and she was clothed with heavenly garments, for she was clothed with the sun, and she was clothed with the moon. These are all celestial and heavenly garments. But the woman of Revelation 12 is clothed with earthly garments. She's decked with earthly garments and material possessions of this world. Look what the Bible says here. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of the abominations of her filthiness, of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written. Notice carefully, she has a name written on her forehead. Listen carefully. Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots, and the abomination of the earth. Here the Bible said this power is one that commits abomination. This woman is one, this church is one that commits an abomination, according to the scriptures. According to the scriptures, this church is called Mystery Babylon because she's in the Eleusinian mysteries of occult practices. This is the real cultic church, or what you call occult issues. Listen very carefully while professing Jesus. Brothers and sisters, I know that people write books on kingdom of cults and everything else, and sometimes they've even tried to make Adventists like we're a cult. Brothers and sisters, but a cult is one who believes that the dead are not really dead, but that the dead actually live on after death. A cult also, according to the Old Testament times, worship idols. A cult also in Old Testament times revered and worshiped the sun, along with greater other abominations, but especially sun worship. Brothers and sisters, this chapter is showing that Mystery Babylon is the greatest occult, religious, professed, so-called Christian power in the world, and nothing more than baptized paganism on top of that. Brothers and sisters, make no mistake about it. God's word is clear. But the issue is, are you understanding what the warning will be soon? This power is called Mystery Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots. She will commit fornication with the kings of the earth. Now, why is that so important? Because in the church of Thyatira, which is representing the same power, she seduced God's servants and led them to commit fornication. Brothers and sisters, we're going to find out what that means. First of all, this whore, according to the Bible, sits on many waters. So what are waters to be? Let's be clear about that first. What are waters? Could somebody read for us Revelation chapter 17, verse 5?
Revelation 17, 5.
Mm-hmm. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abomination of the earth.
Okay, now could you read 17, 15? That's when I'm in. Sorry, I said verse 5. But go ahead, read verse 15.
15, and he said unto me, the waters which thou sawest where the whore sitteth are peoples and multitude and nation and tongues.
Notice the waters where thou sawest the whore sitteth are what? People, multitudes, nations, and tongues. Notice very carefully, the Bible said this whore sits upon multitudes of people. This is dealing with a religious following, brothers and sisters. According to the Bible, this whore also commits fornication with the kings of the earth. Now, does the Bible tell us about this issue? Now, remember, I told you another word for whore is dealing with a strange woman. What does the book of Proverbs have to say about a strange woman? I want you to look at this with me. What does the book of Proverbs have to say about a strange woman? A strange woman is actually represented as a harlot. Go with me in your Bible for a moment to Proverbs chapter 2, verse 16. Proverbs chapter 2, verse 16. Could somebody read that for us? Proverbs 2, verse 16. Proverbs chapter 2, verse 16.
And it reads, to deliver thee from the strange woman, even right, from the stranger.
Start with verse 14 so that people understand why it's saying deliver thee.
Mm-hmm. It says, who rejoice to do evil and delight in the faultiness of the wicked, whose ways are crooked, and they forward in their paths. To deliver thee from the strange woman, even from the stranger which flattereth with her words.
Okay. Now, notice very carefully, flattereth with her words. I want you to notice this. I want y'all to look closer at Proverbs with me as we are looking at this for a moment, because we're dealing with this issue of this woman seducing God's servants, all right? And we want to identify this woman from the scriptures, first of all, and then we're going to identify her according to what the Bible is actually bringing out from the symbolism. Notice very carefully, and I'm going to start with Proverbs chapter 2, and I want to listen to you very, I want you to listen very carefully. Elder King read it, but I want to go a little bit closer. I want to show you the only thing that can keep men from being seduced by this great whore of Revelation chapter 17. And is represented, and she's represented as the church of Thyatira in the Revelation chapter 2, verses 18, 19 through 27. Listen carefully. My son, if thou will receive my words and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thy ear unto wisdom and apply thine heart to understanding, yea, if thou crieth after knowledge, and if thou lifteth thy voice for understanding, if thou seeketh her as silver and searcheth for her as for hid treasures, thou shalt understand the fear of the Lord and find knowledge of God. Now, first, before you go any further, what is it that man needs to do? What is it any man or woman on this earth, if they're seeking God, they're going to need to do in order to be prepared to deal with the harlot that's going to try to seduce them later? They must have the commandments of God and the word of God and the wisdom of God, meaning have a knowledge of God's character, and they must be seeking it as silver. In other words, they must become obsessed with the idea they want to stay in communion with God. Why? Then shall I understand the fear of the Lord and find knowledge of God. For the Lord giveth wisdom, out of his mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. He layeth up sound wisdom for the righteous. He is a buckler to them that walk uprightly. He keepeth the paths of judgment and preserveth the way of the saints. Then shall I understand righteousness and judgment and equity, and yea, every good path. When wisdom entereth into thy heart, the knowledge is pleasant into thy soul, unto thy soul. Discretion shall preserve thee. Watch carefully. This is what Elder King was getting. I didn't take him far enough, but listen. Discretion shall preserve thee. Understanding shall keep thee. To deliver thee from the way of what? First of all, the evil man. Oh, mercy. What? Deliver thee from the way of the what? Evil man, and from the man that speaketh forward things. That means perverse things. Who leave the paths of the upright to walk in the ways of darkness, who rejoices to do evil. Now, this talking about the man that speaks forward things. He leaves the paths of the what? The upright. The man that speaks forward things. He walks in what? The ways of darkness. The man who speaks forward things rejoices to do evil and delights in forwardness and wicked and of the wicked, whose ways are crooked, and they are, and this is here, for they forward in their paths to deliver thee. Now, what's going to deliver thee? The commandments of God. What's going to deliver thee? The wisdom of God. What's going to deliver thee? The knowledge of God and his character. That is what you are needing to deliver you from the evil man and from the man that speaks forward with his mouth and the forwardness of the wicked. But then it doesn't stop there. Listen else what it says, to deliver thee from the strange woman. Uh-oh. Who's the strange woman? The Bible said the word of God and the commandments of God and the knowledge of God and his character must be able to deliver you from who? The strange woman. What type of woman is this? It says a strange woman, even from the stranger which flatter with her words, brothers and sisters. Have mercy. Wait a minute. This is talking about this harlot. This great whore, how will she seduce men? She will seduce men by her words, brothers and sisters. She will seduce men by her alliances that she will make with these men. She will lead them, she will seduce them and lead them into fornication, brothers and sisters. She will bring about a union of church, religion with politics, or church and state. The Bible is telling you what is about that, what is happening in Proverbs is happening on a worldwide basis and scale right now as we talk. You understand this? Look a little closer. It said to liberty from the strange woman, from the stranger which flattereth with her words, who forsaketh the guide of her youth and forgetteth the covenant of her God. Wait a minute. The Bible said this harlot. The Bible said this great whore, Revelation chapter 17, forsaketh the guide of her youth, and it says, forgetteth the covenant of her God. She professes to be of God, but at the same time, she forgetteth the covenant of God. Not only will she forget it, but she will even come to a point where she will think to change the covenant of God. Do you understand what's happening here? Look a little closer with me. What is the covenant dealing with? In Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 13, could somebody read that for us, please? Deuteronomy 4, 13. We read it all the time. What? Can somebody read it for us?
And he declared unto you his covenant, which he commanded you to perform, even 10 commandments, and he wrote them upon 2 tables of stone.
His covenant was the 10 commandments that he wrote on 2 tables of stone, brothers and sisters. How is it the Bible said this power, this woman, this harlot, this one that commits fornication with the kings of the earth are going to forsake, the forgetteth the covenant of her God? And by the way, let me say something else to you. There's only one thing that's supposed to guide a woman or a church if they're really of God, and that is the God, the guide for the church is the Holy Ghost. How do we know? Because the Bible says in John 16, 13, howbeit when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. The church is the youth of the guide of the youth of the church in throughout the centuries has been the Holy Spirit. But the Bible says she forsaketh her guide. She turns away from following the Holy Spirit. In fact, as we get down to the end, she will lead, she will be led. She will grieve and lead others to grieve the Holy Spirit by the violation of God's holy law and the undoing of God's restrictions and his ordinance of his commandments. Brothers and sisters, make no mistake about it. The Bible said her house inclineth unto death. Her paths, now her house, meaning her church, inclines unto death, and her paths unto death, unto the dead. It says, none that go in, go, listen, none that go unto her returneth again. Have mercy. Brothers and sisters, you catch that? None that go in unto her, none that go in and join unto her returneth again. Neither take they hold of the paths of life. Oh, the paths of life. Look at this. Thou mayest walk in the way of good men and keep the paths of righteousness. For the upright shall dwell in the land, and the perfect shall remain in it. But the wicked shall be cut off from the earth, and the transgressor shall be rooted up, uprooted out of it. Now here we found that the strange woman in Proverbs chapter 2, and we read the whole chapter for a moment, Proverbs chapter 2 shows this strange woman is one who forsakes the God of her youth. She flattereth with her lips. So the seduction that will be brought into the church of Thyatira is by a woman, a church that will know how to flatter kings, flatter the servants of God, flatter politicians, if you please. She'll know how to flatter them with her words. My. Spirit of God is giving us a clear warning of what is about to come. We already identified this church as representing the papacy and the papal hierarchy. We know this is not Roman Catholic people per se, though there may be some who follow everything that Rome says and are willing to carry out her bidding and are connected with the secret societies. We know that. But brothers and sisters, overall, this is dealing this particular verse is showing very clearly that Rome is represented as the harlot that goes about seducing the kings of the earth and the servants of God. Brothers and sisters, the question that must be answered right now is, are the servants of God being deceived? I mean, we see it in some of the first day churches, but the question is it happening among us? And that's a good question. And now, and only the word of God can answer it. And I want you to see with me. In fact, let me just read something again with you once so you can get the point with me. First of all, she will go to the kings of the earth. Let me just read some articles to you. And you can find these articles on Advent Messenger. But I just want you to just listen carefully now to what we just read, because the Bible said this strange woman, for the sake of the guide of her youth, meaning, and she will forsake the covenant. So she don't have the spirit of God. She has a spirit. If you don't have the spirit of God, then you have the spirit of devils. Because there's only two powers, two spirits you're going to have under. You have the spirit of God and the spirit of devils. There's no in between. When we don't know Jesus, and we don't have, and we know about him, but we haven't accepted him as our Lord and Savior, we're still being guided, in some cases, by spirits of devils. That's why the Bible said, know ye not to whom you use yourselves servants to obey, his servants you are to whom you obey, whether sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness, Romans 6:16. So, brothers and sisters, let's take a look at this a little closer, and let's examine. I want to read to you for a moment. World leaders agree at COP28 to fund climate-related damages to the developing nations as urged on by Pope Francis in Laudato Si. Like I said, this is just now, I'm just reading some articles so you get the point. So world leaders, I'm talking about political leaders of the earth, are joining in line and fall in line with what the Pope, what Pope Francis want for bringing about the legitimacy and unity of Laudato Si. Listen again. Pope calls on the world to reject nationalism and adopt concrete political changes in response to climate change. Nationalism means one who believes in his own state or government or nation. And a lot of that is connected with patriotism as well. But the Pope is asking you to reject nationalism, to accept the global authority as your guide and no longer your own personal state guide or your own personal patriot idea of how your nation comes about. And you can go back and read more about it. I'm just giving you some ideas, and you can go back and see more. You may even know more about it than what I'm talking about. But I just want you to understand this. But they said it will seduce our servants. Not only did she seduce the servants in the days of the Dark Ages, coming them through the Reformation period, we are talking about people and churches and even among us being seduced today. Let me read this one to you so you can get the point here. And this is very interesting, because I thought I was very interesting. Listen to this. Portraying, in fact, the title is entitled Portraying Sacred Trust. Guillaume Diop tells interfaith leaders gathered at the World Council of Churches headquarters that ecumenism's ultimate goal is to unite the whole world under the lordship of Christ. Wait a minute. Is that how Jesus told us to go about uniting the world? By having ecumenical alliances? Or did Jesus tell us to take the everlasting gospel to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people? Did he tell us that we needed to get with all the religions and join with them in order to do it? Or did he tell us to go proclaim the message with the second angel's message, call the people out of Babylon and call them into the unity of keeping the commandments of God and having the testimony of Jesus Christ? Which one is it? Because today it seems like we have taken a different route in believing how we can take the gospel to the world. When the Bible, when the commission of Revelation 14 is clear that we must present the first, second, and third angel's message. And under the third angel's message, we must proclaim the warning against the worship of the beast, his image, his mark, and the number of his name. Brothers and sisters, make no mistake about it. God's word is clear on this point. But let's go a little bit closer. It goes on. We got men in our, among us in high places that is willing to sell us out for what they call a new world order and a one world religion, a global religion of unity, and as they put it, under the lordship of Christ. But I don't read that. I don't read it like that. I read that all things will be gathered together in one in Christ, and that deals with the transformation of character. That deals with men keeping the commandments of God, and that deals with men having the faith of Jesus. Brothers and sisters, make no mistake about it. There is a unity, and it's supposed to be united on truth and righteousness, not just on common points of doctrine that you have in common, and then say, oh, well, the rest of that which we disagree with, God will sort it out later when we get up there. If you don't sort it out now, you will never be up there. Put it that way for you. God's word is clear. Amen? Amen. And at the same time, it is concerning for us to look at these things and start praying for these brothers like Diop and others, that God will open their eyes before it's too late. I know that there are some who feel that Adventists have been too strict and too enclosed in certain things. And now that when we talk like I'm talking now, all of a sudden we're really kind of like narrow-minded or extremists. That's what you want to call it. But brothers and sisters, I'm talking about Adventism. I am not talking about nominal Adventism in certain circles that we're walking in today. Some places we go, people are practicing Adventism. And in other places we go, there are people are practicing, they're professing Adventism in name only. They're nominal and they're not really Adventists in the real sense of the term. And even though they may be on the church books or on the organization, that doesn't mean that they're solid Adventists when it comes down to the word of God. Isaiah 8:20 says, to the law and to the testimony. If they speak not according to this word, if they don't live according to this word, if their actions and their fruits don't be, is not according to this word, there is no light in them. I'll put it that way for you. And so we have that issue. Why? Because we have lowered the standard on righteousness. We have lowered the standard on dress. We have lowered the standard on the issues that we would sustain from wearing different things like jewelry and makeup and everything. And even men have to be careful about how they dress today, because we got cross-dressing going, all kinds of things. And God tells us a man should not wear that which pertaineth to a woman, and a woman should not wear that which pertaineth to a man. God has been clear about these things for many years, but we have lowered the standard on this thing. We've gotten to the point now where we're letting people come into church with jewelry and earrings on, and we're saying it's okay. We've gotten to church now where they can look like if you playing a hymn, you just must be dead and dried up. If you're not playing some gospel beat and run around jumping up and down in the church, if you're not doing something like that, then you don't have the spirit. We're going by feelings and not by principles, brothers and sisters. All these things are happening among us at this time, and it tells us that we are on the very verge, on the pinnacle of the close of probation, and we were told before probation closed, all type of uncouth things will be brought in, music and all type of things. All these things will be taking place. Mm-hmm. Now, brothers and sisters, I brought you this point because I want you to see, mm-hmm. I want you to see with me what the dangers are of people being seduced, not just by the woman herself, but the woman will be led by the spirits of devils, which will go to seduce more. Look what the Bible says in 1 Timothy 4:1. Could somebody read 1 Timothy 4:1
now? Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils.
In order for the church of Thyatira to seduce Jesus' servants, she must first lead them to depart from the faith. Now, we've talked about this before, but let's break it down a little closer again. What does it mean? Where does faith come from? Where does faith come from? Because it said they're going to depart from the faith. Romans 10:17. Could somebody read that for us?
So in faith coming by hearing, and hearing by the word of God.
All right. So wait a minute. To depart from the faith means they're going to depart from what? The spirits of devils are going to get people to depart from the what? Word of God.
Word of God.
Now we are watching that same departure take place among us. And a few years ago, we started departing from the word of God in the North American division, when we started saying, okay, we're going to ordain elders. We're going to ordain women as elders, I'll put it that way. And then the controversy got so hot that it came to the General Conference, and the brethren at the constituency of the General Conference voted it down. And usually the churches, the leadership of the churches and the conferences and the union will abide by the vote of the constituency. But we turned around and we by Autumn Council, we used kingly power and we overruled the constituency's desire not to ordain women as elders or pastors. And the North American divisions was saying that we need to do it. Dan Jackson and Autumn at the time was saying we need to do it. And Dan Jackson was begging the people to do it, because at the same time, the church is getting money from the government for these situations. I want you to understand what's happening. Sometimes you follow the money, you find out where the corruption is, all right? But just be realistic. So this came in. Then later we got issues going in where we're trying to make it like we need to understand this issue of transgender and everything else. How far is this going, brothers and sisters? I just want you to know. How far you think it's going to go before judgments of God start kicking in? How far you think it's going to go and God's people themselves will no longer be shielded from his judgments because they are in transgression of his law? How far do you think this is going to go, brothers and sisters? That we can trample on God's commandments. We can trample on sound doctrines of the word of God. We can neglect and reject light and truth from the word of God. Plain and simple, that we've had for over 150 some odd years, 170 some odd years as Adventists, and now so we're gonna reject all of it for the sake of liberality. How long you think it's gonna continue? And then we have a so-called conservative class that has been in conservative, but at the same time they have retarded the work of God. Because of lack of conversion. But they have enough intellectual knowledge and understanding of truth to be dangerous. Let's put it that way for you. This is what we got going on. How long do you think this is going to continue? And now we are on the verge of saying that it's time that we join with world religions. And the great harlot, the mother of harlots in Revelation 17, is behind the union that even our people in high places and leaders are falling in. How is this possible at a time like this? Where are the watchmen? Where are the watchmen that lift up their voices and cry aloud and spare not? To show the house of Jacob their transgression, the house of Israel their sins. This is no light thing that we're watching taking place. We're watching confusion come in among our people. We're watching our people lose their sense of identity. How long, brothers and sisters, can we sit back and not say anything? Brothers and sisters, our time is short, and we need to be about our Father's business in this regard. Now, I want to take you back to the PowerPoint for a moment as we're dealing with these issues of the church. And I want to run you back through some of that as we go through it. But before I do, there was an issue that we had last week on last Sabbath evening. And one of our brethren had told us about how the church in 1963 organized itself. And it seemed like everybody was thinking that the church was saying, the brother was saying that the church organized itself in 1963. Well, on one hand, He was bringing out something that happened in 1963, but we know that the church organization took place before that time. But we want you to see carefully, and we want to make it plain what our brother Shalom was trying to share with us. And I want you to see this with me for just a moment. My Mighty Angels team, I want you to see that, right? Okay. Okay, well, I want you to see, we got a little order laid out for you so you can take a look at it with us. And we're going to put it on the screen. I believe my team can put it on the screen. Is that right, team? I think they're right there. They'll let me know in a minute while they're working on that. While they're working on that, I want you to also think in terms of the, we're going to go back to also to the PowerPoint. because I want you to see some things there and you can do some reading for me. But I want to bring some things into this picture so you can understand why God's looking at this issue of the church of Thyatira in such a way. All right. We're putting on the screen the order that you gave me the other day of the time frame when corporation, all these things came into being. We had the church organ. That's what we're going to do. Let me see. Otherwise, that I have to go to my email and read it to you. I want everybody to see, because one of my team went out their way to make sure that they had that thing right, because they didn't want anybody to misunderstand. I want everybody to look at this carefully. In 1849, the first paper of Present Truth was printed in Middleton, Connecticut. In 1850, the first issue of the Second Advent Review and Sabbath Herald was printed in Paris, Maine. In 1860, the name Seventh-day Adventist was adopted by the church. Remember, this is when we also read in testimonies when Mrs. White said God gave us that name. All right, in 1863, listen carefully, 1863, the first general conference and formation of the Seventh-day Adventist Church on May 21st, 1863. Now, everybody see that there? That's when the church was officially organized and we had our first general conference, all right? By 1871, J.N. Andrews sent to Switzerland as a missionary. By 1885, missionary work began in Australia. By 1915, Ellen White died on July 16th at St. Helena, California. By 1941, opening of the theological seminary in Tacoma Park. By 1942, the Voice of Prophecy radio show began broadcasting coast to coast. By 1950, we have Faith for Today TV show began. By 1955, we have SDA membership hits 1 million. By 1986, SDA membership hits 5 million. Wow. But now there's one more. There's one more set we need to find about that leads us up the other part of the list that shows us coming up to the time of the corporation. Can you show that for us, please? Okay. It took me, hold on a minute. Okay. She's looking, she sent in my email and I didn't place to find it. Meanwhile, while they're looking at that, I just want to make sure you understand that according to what we've seen, the church was organized in 1863, May 21st. But now I want you to see, because I want you to be able to clear up so you can see what my brother was talking about, what our brother was talking about last weekend. And so we put it in its proper context so you can see. This is what he was getting at, though. But he was trying to show something, and we're going to show you exactly what it is. This is not okay. The one we want is the article that says in 1963, the church filed for articles of corporation. That's the article we're dealing with. Because that was what Brother Fleming was bringing out. And that was in 1963, 100 years after the church had been organized in 1863. And by this time, the church was now filing for corporation papers. And under the articles of corporation, under trademark laws, we will become not just a church, but we will be a business that offers goods and services. And at the same time, anyone taking the name Seventh-day Adventist could be legally sued by the church under the articles of corporation that they were getting at that time. And that's what we found out in our study. And this is what Brother Fleming was bringing out, that the church in 1963 wrote that they were officially organized. But they were organized not as a church per se, but as a corporation to be actually carry out trade under the trademark laws. And from that time on, they would have power to actually sue people for taking a name or sue them over goods and services necessary. And we know about the Hawaiian lawsuit that took place. We know about the lawsuit also that took place with Elder Perez of South Florida. So I want you to see, this is what we're talking about. So you get the point with here. And so this is what we've been looking at. So I want you to see this so you everybody understand. All right? The General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. Now, this is what Brother Fleming was bringing out. Now, I want you to notice very carefully at the top. It says what, everybody? Trademarks. Everybody said trademarks. Trademark electronic search system. But this is done with trademarks. All right? Trademarks means to file for business corporation papers. I want you to understand what's going on. In other words, you're trademarking the name. You're trademarking what Adventism is. In other words, we're not just a church anymore. We are a corporation. We are a business. And believe it or not, under a corporation business, the church members are like stockholders. All right? You just want you to keep that in mind as you continue to go. And this is why, but at the same time, under this trademark law, sometimes it supersedes that of even your church manual. Listen carefully. Typed and drawing, General Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. Church services, namely rendering ministerial and religious services, first use, listen carefully, talking about this for the issue of trademark, first use, 1963, okay? First used in what? Commerce. What is commerce, everybody? Because nobody tell me what commerce is. Do we need to look it up?
Business.
Business. So what's happening here? The church has become now what?
A business.
So if it's a business, then and then say they can under business issue, they can now use a what? They can file for trademark issues, and that's why people get sued for taking the name Seventh-day Adventist and not have the permission of the church or the conference. Mm-hmm. And everybody see that there? I want you to see typed. Okay, serial number. You got your serial number there. You got your filing date, May 7th, 1980. Current basis, original filing, okay, 1A, published on for opposition on July. In other words, anybody want to oppose it, they should oppose it on July 7th, 1981. If the registration took place when? 3 months later, July and September 29th, 1981. Then it says here what? Registrant, the General Conference Corporation. Did you see everybody now? The General Conference Corporation of what? Seventh-day Adventists. The what corporate? Let me change my screen for just a second. I'll make sure you read this whole thing. Want to make sure you understand exactly what we're talking about, so you get the point with us. Listen carefully. The General Conference Corporation of Seventh-day Adventists, the Corporation DC 12501 Old Columbus. Let's give an address: Old Columbus Pike, Silver Springs, Maryland. Assignment recorded: Jennifer Woods. Okay, it's there. This is what Brother Fleming was getting into when he talked about this issue. This is when we were organized as a corporation for trademarking and becoming a business. We no longer just considered a church. And at the same time, we can, this is what we saw. All right. Is that clear to everybody? Yes. I hope it is.
Yes.
Sometimes yes. It's even, sometimes even shocking to see that we have gone that far.
Mm-hmm.
And now you understand why when COVID-19 came out, we were able to file under businesses, under a business, and get a kickback from the government. Many churches did it, not only Adventists, but some many churches did it, get a kickback from the government because we as a business have employees and our employees cannot get paid because of the lockdowns. And you remember that Amazing Facts was about to do the same thing, but then later they changed their mind and returned the money. You remember that?
Yes.
Yes. I remember so
I wanted, okay. Yeah, I just want you to see. So this is what went on. And so these are things that are there, brothers and sisters, and we are heading, and we're heading for this time. If we do this in the dry, in the green tree, what are we gonna do in the dry?
Hmm.
Hmm? If we do Pastor this now, Barry, what are we going to do later? Yes.
I've been informed by certain people that these are grounds for leaving the church and taking your names off the books and walking away from the Seventh-day Adventist Church and not even using the name.
Mm-hmm. First of all, there's a lot of other things that are taking place. But I'm not, I'm gonna tell you like this. I know that I know there's people out there doing that, but yep. when the church, to me, there are things that are taking place where people are being put out the church already because they made a stand for the message and for different things of that nature. We should inquire about where our money goes. We should inquire about how it's being spent. Because the biggest issue, that the only way you're going to get this church attention is you got to deal with their money. Leaving the church, you can leave, but at that point, that's not that. That's just you going out the door, but it doesn't help the people in church itself going out. They're still there.
Okay.
They're still sitting there believing everything is fine, because their time until some of us, enough of us start speaking out to start awakening God's people. We can't, and Mrs. White said, with this new organization that we see taking place, she said, nothing will stand in the way of it.
Amen.
We are watching it. So we, at this point, we do what we can. But brothers and sisters, if they're going to persecute you, if this is going to get too bad, then go to another church. If it gets to the point, sometimes you don't have to worry about taking your name off. They'll take it off for you.
Right.
But in some cases, if we see blatant error like this, depending on where you may be at, I'm not sure, it may be a situation where it may necessitate you removing your name from the books.
Pastor Berry, I got a question.
Each case, each area is a little bit different. Uh-huh, but go ahead.
Yeah, I got a question.
Thank you.
Like, would it be a sin to take your tithes and offering and like give it to a self-supporting ministry, like Apocalypse Ministry, or like a major...
Okay, first of all, let me say this to you. First of all, the spirit of prophecy is very clear. No man, how many men? No man has the right to tell you where you should pay your tithe and offering. That is a conscience decision between you and the Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit impresses you that you should no longer support the institution because of certain XYZs, and you have the facts right before you, then you follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. There is no pastor, Amen. No present true pastor, nor organized pastor that has the right to tell you where you need to pay your tithe. Yes, in times past, the church has been considered the storehouse, but Ellen White has made it very clear that the church is not the only storehouse. She said the storehouse is represented also by the men who preach and teach the gospel of Christ.
Amen.
Amen.
To support the gospel minister. That's who the real storehouse is. All right? It's very, very clear. First Corinthians, Paul made it very clear. So they said, but though Paul was a self-supporting preacher, in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, Paul is a self-supporting preacher because the people in Corinth have questioned his apostleship and decided that because he was not among the 12, that he does not deserve support as Peter, James, or John would. And Paul said to that same group of people, I robbed other churches to come here with you. In other words, rob meaning that I had other churches supporting me when you refused to support me, even though you are the fruit of my labor. In other words, the church in Corinth got started by Paul. They're his fruit, and they're talking about they don't want to support him because they don't believe they question his apostleship as being an apostle called out of due time.
I have a very important question when you can.
Go ahead.
Okay. I've been studying this issue of 501c3 corporations. And what you just presented, this issue of the dates when this corporation or business was started.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not an expert on this, but I've been studying this very much. And as I understand, a corporation is a fictitious individual. It's a creature of the state. Is that true?
That's right. That's absolutely true.
The church is the body of Christ created by him, by divine power. For we are his workmanship created in Christ Jesus, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
When they formed this corporation, which is a fictitious individual or creature of the state, that I conclude that they form the new organization. That a fictitious individual cannot be the church. A creature of the state cannot be the church. So where did the Seventh-day Adventist Church go?
But the creature of state cannot be a church, but the creature of state can be a business.
Yeah.
They form the new organization. What happened to the regular church? Where did it go?
The regular church is no longer exists in the truest sense of the term, except by those who are faithful members. Where two or three got my name, faithful souls constitute God's church in every age. The organized church is when before they went here, they were represented, and they're supposed to be representative of God's people. The Bible said, love not the world, not the things in the world. What fellowship of light with darkness? Or the temple of God with temple of devils? We weren't supposed to even go here. This is just about as bad as when we were warned from the spirit of prophecy that we were not to have our schools accredited.
So how can I conscientiously hold membership in a creature of the state?
Well, that's something that is something that you and the Holy Spirit will have to decide, because this is the whole idea. There are a lot of things in this church that can cause you to stumble. But I'll tell you one thing right now. The church, the doctrines of Adventism, the first, second, and third angels' messages, I don't care where you go, I don't care what you do after what you've seen and what has bothered you. One thing we need to be doing is speaking up about it. Number two, no longer become passive laymen. We've been passive laymen too long. And as a result of that, we have watched other laymen become assassinated in character and everything else for standing up for what they knew to be right. Just like you're sitting here now with a conscience being inflamed, not inflamed, but awakened to see that something's wrong. Our church has become an agency of the state. All Protestant churches and all evangelical churches in America, through faith-based initiative programs, going all the way back to George Bush by 2006 made the churches agencies of the state. That's why this issue of 501c3 was so important, because 501c3 was a tax break. But on one hand, 501c3 would take away the church's right to be immune from being taxed by the government. Because they gave them they put a carrot out there. They said, look, we will give you a tax-free status and we will let your members be tax-free. But while doing that, they took us off the constitutional right for the minister or the church not to be taxed, because it was a constitutional right. But when we accepted 501c3, we moved off that constitutional right. When we accepted the Johnson Amendment, that's why Donald Trump, that's why the churches could not vote, they couldn't say anything, and that's why Donald Trump says, if I get elected, I'll remove the tax-exempt status that's been under y'all, that's keeping you from the right to vote. Because he knew that the church had the greatest voting power and was the greatest silent voting bloc in America. That's what he knew that. And our people, unfortunately, many of our people don't know these things, and some of them don't care to know, because they think they're going to get bogged down in a bunch of politics and everything else. Brothers and sisters, you got something more deadly coming. You got the image of the beast being formed. We were warned not to have our schools accredited. We were warned not to practice certain types of drug medications. We were warned as a people not to bring our churches under the control of the state.
Man,
you know what's interesting, Pastor Barry? What you were saying about Donald J. Trump, when he endorsed the church and even the black church, that's actually what gave him the winning vote to get in office.
That's right. Absolutely.
I ended up calling it out, and I called it out that summer. It was like in June or July, I called it out. So what's also interesting is the church received, I want to say like 2012, 2013, and 14, the church received like several billion to GC the tithe. But it's like the General States Conference that I came out of, I used to always say the ministers and GC and Sister State's president always say, well, we're in trouble. We need such and such amount of this and such and such amount of that. And I'm like, if they bringing in billions of dollars in tithe, how it is that these ministers always getting up asking for money for this project or that project? Like, it because just never makes sense to me.
Good question. And not only that, but then you also got to remember that as a business, we also can invest in what? In the stock market. And we got money sitting in the stock market. Mm-hmm. Tide money.
Mm-hmm.
If we're going to talk about these things and put in this right light, it's there. Brothers and sisters, sin is sin. Why do you think Jesus was cleansing the temple from all the money changers? We got money changers among us. And the love of money, not money itself, but the love of the money is the root of all evil.
So here's another important question, if I can.
Go ahead.
Does our First Amendment rights, like freedom of speech, does it end at the church door? Do we have First Amendment rights even in worship service? For example, if someone is preaching error or simply not preaching the truth. Let's say someone is preaching a sermon that's purely evangelical, and during that sermon you make a comment respectfully, peacefully, you make a comment. Now some people believe that's rude, they get upset, but that does the First Amendment protect? Do we have freedom of speech in that situation? Because the reason
Okay, the reason why, first of all, we do have the right of First Amendment rights, even if you come down to the church, and I'm going to tell you why. Because remember, the right to free speech, before it became a civil issue, it was also, above all, a religious issue. That's why the issue, when we saw the situation break out with the great pandemic, we asked the question, is this a religious issue? And everybody said, no, this is not a religious issue. This is not a religious liberty issue. But the moment you closed down the church, the moment you told people, begin to tell people that they had to accept the narrative without the evidence, and when people found evidence contrary, you begin to put it, that was a civil and religious liberty issue. And you do not have civil liberties without first having religious liberty. Religious liberty made the way for you to have civil liberties. When we go back to read the history of Roger Williams, you know, most of our people trace our independence back to 1776. That's what most of American revisionists want you to believe. But brothers and sisters, our independence of the nation, of our free speech of the nation, our religious and later civil liberties are all going back to 1610 and from that time up, because we were escaping the tyranny of Romanism. Our forefathers were escaping the tyranny of Romanism when they came to the shores of America, brother. That's why you read in Great Controversy, they got down on Plymouth Rock and they said, give us a country without a king and a religion without a pope. So, and then that's why we have the separation of church and state, contrary to what's being told us now, that certain states should never be separated. This is all infiltration of Jesuitism, and we see it clearly as day. So I want to make it plain, but as far as our religious liberty is concerned, our religious liberty does not stop at the church. It actually began with the church. So, and it also began with the days of the Protestant Reformation as well. Okay? The papacy was the one that wanted to suppress free speech. Y'all remember that from the very beginning. And to give men liberty of conscience, she called that a pestilent era of the worst kind. And here we are in the church today, and when somebody wants to speak up or say something, sometimes some people are forced to address something openly, because there's no room and no one will give them the actual hearing in a right and fair hearing
if they kept, if sometimes they don't open their mouth, believe it or not, among us. We're so used to wanting to keep the status quo. We don't want to rock the boat. You know, we all at good old Adventist now, we don't want to upset the pastor. If the pastor's preaching error, he now need to be upset. He need to be called out. Amen. You cannot sit, or you just get up and leave, because the spirit of prophecy said we are not to sit under error. We are not to sit there and placate with that stuff. And I had a situation, like I told you before, there was a pastor who was up there serving a wafer for communion. And the people were getting all upset and everything else. And I saw it. I saw what was going on. And I said, okay. The Lord said, if you have aught with your brother, go to him. I waited for some of the people to, you know, go in line. And some people just kept complaining, going out the door, talking about it in the yard, out there in the parking lot and everything else. I said, no, I'm not going to the parking lot to talk about it. I'm going to go straight to him, because this is wrong. And I said, Pastor, I said, you a pastor of Seventh-day Adventist Church? Yes. I said, you got your doctorate? He said, yes. I said, now you, that means you have a clear understanding of the communion service in Adventism. Oh, yes, yes, yes. I said, well, why are you serving the wafer? Why are you serving the good God cookie? Why are you serving Roman Catholic Renaissance? And why are you teaching that? Why are you got us reading the Catholic liturgy, which is the doctrine of transubstantiation, where we bring Christ down and we crucify him anew? And he got mad. He didn't want to. Who are you? What is your name? I said, Pastor, it doesn't matter what my name is, but I'll tell you anyway. I said, but I need you to answer my question. Well, that's all we had. We didn't have no unleavened bread and all that. I said, well, if you didn't have that, you shouldn't have had a communion service. Because you got the people eating and drinking to an abomination. Now, I didn't go out in the parking lot having to discuss it with other Adventists, like we got to get a rally alley going. The Bible said if you got aught with your brother, you go to your brother with that issue. You don't keep talking about it with other people.
None.
But we don't do that. We talk around and everything else, and then we start later. We beat around the bush, and we don't get to the point. We're in a time, brothers and sisters, when we are about to watch the image be formed. Adventists are tested on the image of the beast, not the mark.
Amen.
Do you understand this? And the image of the beast will be formed before probation closed. For this is the great test that the people of God must have, by which they will be sealed. This is where we are. And that's why I said, how long are we going to sit back and just watch like we just passive ducks on a fence? What's going on here? We got gag orders? Everybody supposed to be quiet?
Yeah.
No. The Bible said, cry loud and spare not. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. It's time to warn God's people, brothers and sisters. And you know what? It's not like you just I get a kick out of attacking the church. I do not. And you know that. You should know that by now in our program. But there are moments when we do have to call sin by his right name and just tell it like it is. But you know, that's not my hobby horse, all right? I will call it when I see it. I'm just saying, like, yeah, I try to be careful, tappy tap. I've seen what happened when people walk away from the church and they get in some self-supporting groups and they think they're better than other people. And then all of a sudden that self-supporting group leader there or whoever it is falls out or goes out or falls from grace or whatever the case may be. The people stumble and they almost can't even hold on to Adventism and the true teachings and doctrines any longer. Next thing you know, they're out in the world and they don't want to have nothing to do with none of them. I done seen that too. And I done seen others go back to Adventism because they thought that the being in present truth was too extreme. So they got out of present truth, went back into the church and became an enemy to present truth and anything that looks resembles it, even though present truth is the first, second, and third angels' messages that are to be preached even in the Seventh-day Adventist organized church.
Amen.
I done seen Amen. That too. So if you think it's holier on the outside, many times it's not. And you got to watch your back even more. And if you think you're going to get by on the inside, where things are, and you're just going to follow the status quo and not lift up your mouth when you see wrong going on, you got another thing coming on that too. Because for every evil that you see take place in that church and you don't open your mouth, God will hold you accountable for watching it and not saying anything. For him to know to do good and do it not, to him is sin. And there have been a lot of present true people that have walked away from the self-supporting ministries because of wrongdoing that was done there, which they had a right to do, to walk away. And they went back in the organized church and they shut their mouths and decided to go along with everything that they said, come what may, and reject the first, second, and third angels' messages while they know they need to still be preached in the church. Sad. Brothers and sisters, let me say something to you. If God, if somebody hurt you in self-supporting work and you decide you're going back to the organized church, we all came from the organized church. So if you sit there talking about, well, the organized church has become Babylon, then you're lying, because God says very clearly that the Holy Spirit has not given you that message. When our church crossed that line and started keeping Sunday, then you can go there. But until our church crossed that line and we really officially join with Rome, you can't go there. So therefore, you need to be preaching this message straight, even in the organized church, and trying to wake God's people up and teaching the laymen, teaching them straight, and teach them how to give straight Bible studies and bring people in right and get baptized into the power of God and the righteousness of Jesus Christ. And if we were really doing our job, there wouldn't be hardly no need for none of this self-supporting stuff that we see taking place. And the self-supporting workers and men are only as good as they are faithful to God. The moment they begin to take matters beyond what God require, or begin to think that they are in charge and they're going to have lord over God's people, they too will fall and be taken out. And the difference is, when they go, they are gone and they are not rising again. An organized church member can fall and he can be moved around, but it's self-supporting, because God held you to a higher standard. You professed a higher faith than your brethren over in our organized church. Then you, when you fall, your fold is even greater reproach than what they have done over there, because you knew better. There was no excuse for your fault. There was no excuse for your transgression. There was no excuse for the evil that you have done and the stumbling you have caused for God's people. That's for real. That's the real deal.
Amen.
And that's why I keep telling you, you can think you're holy in here and holy over there. You better pray, because we are sinners. And we need to be saved by the grace of God. But we better hold on to this first, second, and third angel's message. We better hold on to the present truth, no matter where you are. And you better hold on to it. If that part where you are and the self-supporting let you down, you better hold on. And if the organized church go a break, you better hold on to the message and to the commandments of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. Because in the end, that's what's going to stand. Conference is going to fail. Self-supporting ministries are eventually going to fail. They're going to cut off every earthly support. Your faith will be in the Word of God and the Bible, and the Bible alone, along with the spirit of prophecy.
Amen and amen.
Amen, Pastor.
That's up. Where it's at, brothers.
Amen.
I just want to make a claim for you. Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Yes, there's nothing wrong with present truth, but people start looking at present truth as a man.
Uh-huh.
And they don't get mad at the man per se. They get mad at the message, or they just link the message with the man.
That's right.
And that's
what happens
together. They throw the baby out with the bathwater.
Mm-hmm. And why is that happening like that? Because some of us who are holding on to present truth are not sanctified by the very present truth that we claim that we want to preach to others. And we're not bearing the fruit of the Spirit on how we talk to our brethren and how we act towards our brethren and sisters in the church in present truth circles. Some of us are cold as ice. Mm. And some of us are so loveless, you wonder, did we ever understand what love was?
Amen.
I mean, I've been in this message for over 40 years. How in the world are you going to sit there and tell me that we're going to make it, but you're going to mistreat your brother in present truth circles? Or you're gonna be a presence who preaching, you run around with every you're chasing every skirt around.
Have mercy.
No, that ain't happening, brothers and sisters. You're on your way to hell, okay? And you're gonna take a lot of people with you because they're gonna stumble at your foolishness and gonna lose their own salvation because they're looking at you and not Jesus.
Amen.
That's what the downfall, looking at man and looking at Jesus.
And that's what happens. That's why the Bible said, I'm so glad the scripture said, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, not man.
Amen. Pastor Barry, go ahead.
Uh-huh.
You know, this morning in my worship and meditation, the Lord took me somewhere that was really, we all know it, and that was John 17:20. And that was the prayer that he was praying for the disciples. But what really got me is when he said that that they all may be one as he is with the Father, that the Father made his name. He said, I have declared, that's verse 20, all the way to 26. Uh-huh. I mean, and so when I think about what's going on, present truth, ordinary, unordinary, you know, God will have a people. And I know I'm not lifting you up, but I really appreciate your ministry. I appreciate your ministry.
God be the glory for that.
Calling sin by its right name. And I know that's the Holy Spirit. So I just wanted to share that John 17, anybody want to go? It's just a nice passage to read that we may be one. And those who don't want to unite with God up under his being obedient to him, then those are the ones that will be separated, the wheat and the tares.
Brothers and sisters, we need to understand one other thing. That before long, all Seventh-day Adventists who believe this three angels messages are going to be one. All Seventh-day Adventists who really become partakers of Christ's righteousness and are sanctified are going to be one. It's not going to be no self-supporting, not going to be no organized. We're going to be one very soon. I want you to understand. And so if we're going to be one, we better start learning how to get along with each other. And even if the brethren in our organized church, because of personal prejudice or prejudice some pastor, start acting crazy with you, or don't you treat them like they treat you.
Amen.
Treat them like a brother. Treat them like a sister, just the same. Treat them like you always knew them before you even came across present truth. And Amen. Let them and ask God to help you show that, help you reveal to them Christ's love and Christ's righteousness in your own life. Because in the end, they still are brothers and sisters.
Amen.
They're not our enemies yet. And I say yet because some are going to go into strong illusion and breathe the Holy Spirit, and they will be your enemy. And just like you're going to have some in present truth in the self-supporting group, that's also going to breathe the Holy Spirit and be an enemy to the cause.
That's right.
But as the Holy Spirit being poured out for those, wherever we are, who are faithful to God, we're going to be one after a while, brothers and sisters. Don't you worry. All things are going to be gathered together in one in Christ. And that is by the Spirit of the living God and his right and Christ's righteousness.
That's right.
We're going to be one, brothers and sisters. And if our name's in that book of life, if our name's in that book of life, whether you're in an organized church or of you out here in self-supporting, if your name remains in that book of life and you confess and put away your sins and receive his righteousness, I got news for you. We all will be one.
Amen.
And we'll be standing all together waiting on the second coming of Christ.
Amen.
That's right. Amen.
Pastor Barry, there are two questions if you would like to take
two
them.
Questions. Okay, go ahead.
The first one was, someone wants to know where in E.G. White it speaks about self-supporting ministers. And the
self-supporting ministers, okay.
Yes, the support that needs to be given to self-supporting ministers.
So you can read about that in the Watson letter. It's called the Watson letter, and you can read about that, or you can get Spoden and McGann collection and look at page 421 and 422, where you can read right there in Spoden and McGann collection, pages 421, 422, that she says that the conference is not the only storehouse, and that the storehouse belongs to those who are preaching and teaching the gospel. That I'm paraphrasing, but that's how she puts it. And she had the Watson letter where she said, with Black ministers in the South and some poor white ministers in the South that were preaching, and they were not getting supported by the organized church. And brothers and sisters gave Ellen White their tithe, and Ellen White, and they asked her, can you give it to places that need it? And she gave it to these different ministers that without their preaching and teaching, they would not get any support from the brethren.
All right.
And she told them, don't make a big deal out of it. Mm-hmm. But that was Elder, because one of the conference leaders named Watson, he got so upset with the idea that people were taking the tithe and giving it to Ellen White, and since she had appropriated different fields and all this other stuff, that he got mad and told the people who received that money that they need to turn all that money back into the conference. Mm-hmm. And Ellen White said that not so. That money was to support those men who were laboring in word and doctrine, preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. So it's clear. Yeah. But nobody can tell you where to pay your tithe. If you want to pay it to the organization, you can do that. God is not going to stop his blessings because you give tithe to the organization.
That's right.
But God's going to also mm-hmm. deal with the organization in time. And you also mm-hmm. remember the Spirit of Prophecy writings that said very clearly that God will have a sanctified ministry before it's all over with.
Amen.
All right. And mm-hmm. we also know that the structure that we are now under is going to be destroyed. If you go back and read the letter where Mrs. White is walking to the train station, and as she walks to the train station, an elder asks her, what's going to happen to the structure? She said the whole structure will be destroyed. And happens to be scattered. Mm-hmm. And they'll come together in little companies mm-hmm. and they'll be praying for who and through the power of the Holy Spirit, they will appoint over them leaders that will help them in the time when the people mm-hmm. of God will need it the most.
That's right.
Thank you, Pastor Barry.
We're heading for these events, brothers and sisters. Mm-hmm. And there's no sense in playing games about it. That's why we ought not be playing games in our local churches. I don't care what church you're in, self-supporting or if an organized church, you need to be about your Father's business. You need to be working to win souls. Yeah. I can't bring nobody in here because everybody's like that. Well, find a church that you can go to where people are holding on to sound doctrine still, because all our Adventist mm-hmm. churches are not gone. And there are some that are still trying to hold on. And under that church mm-hmm. and under that administration, go out there and work and bring some souls to Jesus. And if you're in the self-supporting work, then you need to go out there. You say, well, mm-hmm. people don't come in when they're self-supporting. Let me tell you something. I had one of our first meetings this summer in a self-supporting church in Huntsville, Alabama, and five souls that were non-Adventists made decisions to join that self-supporting church. Mm-hmm. You know why? You know why this is happening now? Before, it would never, I know, because before it wouldn't happen. But you know why it's happening now? Because of the position that we took as a church on the issue of same-sex marriage.
Mm-hmm.
Brother, mm-hmm. You can play, mess around if you want to, but now God's about to let the rocks cry out, and God's about to bring in people of a rough exterior and bring them in under the first, second, and third angels' messages, and they're going to come in and they're going to start replacing folk eventually.
Amen. God, no time to lose. God's He's even at us, the door.
We God's not playing with us. No matter how we want to play church or pretend or act intellectually like we know everything. That's why I tell you, I don't know everything, and I'm not trying to be. You can agree with me tonight, and you can say, I don't agree with nothing that man said. He's just a straight-up fanatic. You can call me whatever you like. It ain't, and I've been there, seen that, done that. For if you worked in that field as a call porter like I did back in the day and some others that I know, and we went from house to house receiving all type of belligerent, cursed out, all things under the sun, but a child of God, just for selling the book, Great Controversy, Desire of Ages, Patriots and Prophets and Prophets and Kings. And then I come into the church, and now people are going to act crazy in the church in these last few years. And then others are going to falsely accuse you of things never taught to you in their life and going to tell you that you are in error or you this or that. I'm, brothers and sisters, you done seen everything of your son as a missionary. So when you come into church and you see certain things, it don't surprise me what I see now. Because I know what it means to be a missionary, and I know what it means to carry this message. And I'm not the only one, but there's some others out there that know what it means in house-to-house labor. But brothers and sisters, we know from experience now, we ain't got time to fool around with God's people. We got time to give this message out to people who don't know it. And for God's people, we got to tell it straight and hope that hopefully they might wake up and get straight themselves.
Amen.
That's what this is all about, brothers and sisters. We're told very clearly we don't have a lot of time to spend on people who know the truth already. We need to be trying to reach those out there that don't know it. There are people perishing right there in your neighborhood because nobody's bringing the truth to them anymore. You got books and tracts and literature. You say, well, I don't know the 2020 days. I didn't actually know the 2020 days. You know the plan of salvation, don't you? Well, take what you know and go on out there and pass out them literature and tell the people about the love of Jesus. And then point them to the commandments of God. And then as time goes on, God will give you wisdom, knowledge, understanding as you're giving them Bible studies to those non-Adventists. And all of a sudden, your knowledge will increase. Your understanding will increase. And you'll be like, boy, I never knew. Now I understand the 2020 days. Man, now I understand everything else that we were talking about, those things that we heard. Now I understand it. Why? Because you're laboring for souls. If you want to understand this message really good, go out there and start working for souls. And you will understand this message like you never understood it before. Go out there and contend with first aid ministers and Jehovah's Witnesses while you're at it, because you're going to run across them. And ask, then go to God on your knees and ask him for wisdom to know how to deal with your enemies. And then by the time you get through going through that, you become a soldier, but you become a man of experience. And as time goes on, when you have to deal with God's people in the church, you realize you cannot play with them. You didn't play with the people out there, so you can't play with the people in here either. You got to tell it straight.
Amen.
Okay, that's all it's true. That's a straight testimony. Straight testimony is just people coming out telling it straight. They're not beating around the bush. They're not making no pretense for you. They're not building no false. They're not putting no false mortar on the wall. They're telling you what needs to be there and what the wall stands for and what brick got to be put there. This is what we're talking about.
All right, Pastor Perry.
So, brothers and sisters, you know, we're dealing with the Church of Thyatira. But I wanted to show you that the things that are happening at that time is happening now. Our people have been seduced. And we're watching it go on. We're seduced by the money. We're being seduced by the world and what the world wants us to do, because the world is heading for world government, world one world currency, one world religion. And in order to do it, they got to lead you to start giving up what you once believed concerning your patriotism, concerning what you believe that your fires, your ethnicity, or even your heritage and everything else. All that's being totally wiped away, to the point you will not have an identity, but the identity of the global good of the world. The global good of world religion. We're watching it being played out on a scale unprecedented right now. And God wants you ready, brothers and sisters. Believe it or not, he wants his church ready. God loves his church. He loves his people in the church. He loves the good, and he loves the bad. But he will deal with the bad, and he will deal with transgression and sin, brothers and sisters. Make no mistake about it. And he will chasten us if need be. And he will let us come under judgments if we're too stubborn to turn away from sin and iniquity. But brothers and sisters, in love, God will deal with his church. And he will raise up men like John the Baptist and Elijah to give this final message under the third angel's message to his people in these last days.
Amen. And Pastor Barry. Mm-hmm. I just have to say that, you know, because it's so many of us have been walking around in darkness. And I'm including myself, of course, even though I study, but it takes men who is not afraid to call sin by its right name. And that's how else are we going to wake up if we don't hear from the pastors that God has given? Yeah, we do study. We have to study. But if God chose certain people, and we have to, as laymen, we still have to do our part too. But I praise God anyway. I'm done with that part. But
what did the Spirit of Prophecy tell us? He said God will raise up men in the last days not qualified by literary institution of learning. They'll be qualified by the unction of his Spirit. The word unction means the anointing of his Holy Spirit. Go back and look at the word up if you don't believe it. In other words, God's about to raise up men, laymen, who don't have the education of all our institutions, but who do have an education under the Holy Ghost in the schools of Christ and self-sacrifice and self-denying labor, and who will be educated to give this message. Now, any of us can qualify for it. And then we need to understand that this is one reason why we why God has been giving us to try to rehearse our history. Because we don't even know our history anymore. We don't even know what we really believe anymore. This is why we went over this is why I was going over the issue of the daily. And this is why we went over the issue about the even when I went talked about the 2520 not being a time prophecy, but showing you it's still a prophecy. And the chronology of that prophecy is actually telling you about the history of the daily and everything else. The chronology is still there. It's not a time prophecy, but the chronology of the events and when it took place is still important for us to understand.
Yes.
But our people have been so kept out of you mentioned certain things, and all of a sudden everybody thinking you're talking some strange stuff because they don't know the history. Brothers and sisters, if the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? Your past history is your foundation. Your past, your understanding of how we got the spirit of prophecy, your understanding of how the first, second, and third angels' messages came to God's people, your understanding of the early history of the Millerite movement and how that connects to the organization and foundation of the Seventh-day Adventist Church is all one big package of history that we need to know. And we should have been rehearsing it over and over and over again in our early history of our Sabbath school lessons. Was rehearsed that way. But as time went on and men become more educated, they begin to think that history was not important anymore, even though the spirit of prophecy said we should rehearse it over and over, and we should teach Adventists that the sure word of prophecy is the foundation of our faith in Adventism, believe it or not, along with Christ our righteousness. She made it very clear. But we see these things, and now we're in the time that we always heard would come, but never thought it was going to come upon us in our time and generation. From now, we're in a time, brothers and sisters, where we don't have the freedom to speak freely anymore on lines. Now we're in the time when we don't have the privilege of saying what we said back in 2015 and 2016. Now we are in a time when everything we're saying is being censored, recorded, and used for data to be used against you in a time of condemnation. When you don't want to go along with the global good or the global world religion.
Mm.
Brothers and sisters, it is time now to arise and shine. For our light has come. Now, this was not what I intended to bring up when we were talking about the Church of Thyatira. But sometimes I have to let the Holy Spirit have his way.
Amen.
Sometimes no matter how rigid we prepare a message, no matter how much we have laid down, if there are certain things the Spirit of God once said, we must be free in mind and in heart and under the power of his Spirit to let these things sometimes be brought up.
Yes.
So that people can have clarity and they're not thinking they're going crazy as they have seen certain things taking place in the churches.
Yes.
You know, there are people have been mistreated, all type of stuff. And they're wondering, am I the only one? Is anybody else seeing this stuff that's going on? And some are in distress because they love the church. As much as you and I love this church, we don't hate this Adventist church. At least I don't. I'm not out here preaching self-supporting because I hate the church. I'm preaching self-supporting because there were many times when I tried to apply to get it to work in the conferences. I worked in the conference for many years as a call porter. I had license and credentials in the work. So I know I'm not talking no fly-by-night stuff. All right. And I've seen what goes on. I had license even as a lay pastor in the church. And they made me a lay pastor because I was a graduate from Heartland College, and they didn't want to pay me because I was a graduate from Heartland College, and I wound up pastoring church for 5 years for free. Now you tell me about that one. And the only thing the church gave me was a little money for gas. And God made a way for me to take care of my family during that time because of the prejudice in some conference leader, because I was a graduate from Heartland College.
Have mercy.
Okay, but I didn't. That ain't gonna deter me. That didn't cause me to hate the church, or I'm gonna turn my guns on the church and I'm gonna show them who I am. No, I didn't have to do all nothing like that. I still had one thing in my mind. I gotta win souls.
Hallelujah.
I gotta go take this message to people in this neighborhood. I want to build my church, and I did. We was able to do that. Okay, and then one day they came to me and told me, "So look here. You want to be part of, we like you, we want you to be part of this, sign a letter saying that you won't have nothing to do with self-supporting work anymore. Sign a letter that you'll make sure all the tithe come to the conference." Just sign the letter. And I'm not making nothing up. You know, some people, I don't know what other people are thinking out there, but I'm not making this stuff up. I'm telling you straight up. That's what they told me. And they said, "We'll let you, if you sign the letter, we'll keep you on and you can go to Andrews University and everything else. But you got to admit, you're not going to have nothing to do with Colin Standish, Russell Standish, none of those people anymore. Especially where you graduated from." And they said, here, sign it. They just signed the letter. And I said, "I can't do it." I said, "Because I've been knowing the men all my life, knowing my men all these years. As I work with these men and everything else, and there's no biblical evidence anywhere that tells me I need to sign a letter denouncing these men." I said, "I can't do it." I said, I'll resign. And I wound up resigning from the conference. And I was a lay pastor at that time. So I'm just telling you, I didn't saw this stuff, all right? I'm not telling you something I read in a book. Or what somebody else said. I know what I'm talking about. I've seen it in the publishing world. I've seen them take money and turn around and say, sell some oranges, and then turn around and call them book sales. All right. I love publishing more than I love preaching. And my publishing director said, you just go along with the program. I said, "I can't do that." And he said, "You like sandpaper. Everywhere you go, you scratch. No, you just won't obey."
Men who so would not be
what you supposed to do? To sit there and just be a yes man? When they say jump, you say how high? With no fear of God before you? Because you want to keep a job in the conference? Because you want to look good? Brothers and sisters, there's more to life than that. There's more to fearing God than fearing man. And I realized I had to answer to God. When I was a call porter, I had to answer to God. It was God that took care of me when I was a call porter. It was God that gave me all my book sales that I received. It was angels of God working on hearts that protected me from violence and from criminals and everything else while I was out there selling books and gun shops and everything else. And then I'm going to come into church and I'm going to play with y'all, right? No. No. God has called us now for such a time as this. And he has called us to give a message and uncompromising. So be of good courage, brothers and sisters. And God be willing. We'll see you. We'll prepare for next Sabbath, Friday night, when we get ready for our next meeting. We went over, but I want to say thank you so much for all of you tuned in. I hope you go back and search these things out and study them out. I know there's some very strong issues that we've talked about here for some, but brothers and sisters, don't take me at my word. Go back and search it out. That's all I'm telling you. I'm not trying to be fine. I'm just giving you a little idea, and I just shared with you some experiences so you understand that I'm not sitting here with, I don't have no personal axe to grind or no grudge, because Jesus, every time I had an issue, I took it to Jesus. I didn't look at man. I looked at Jesus, and Jesus told me how to keep working and keep looking at working for souls and not worry about some things that go on with these men. Because if I did, I've been out of Adventism. But because I kept my eyes on Jesus, I can still say that God is good. And I can still say the Seventh-day Adventist Church is still God's church. And when we cross that line, We cross that line, brothers and sisters, for keeping Sunday, and we start promoting it openly among our churches and telling our church members to do so, then we got a problem. And we don't worry. You ain't got to worry if we're going to go there or not. We're going there. We're heading there fast, too. But we're not quite there yet to start calling the Adventist Church anything but what it is. God, it's God's remnant church. And it's just sad that we have watched this stuff go on. And it's sad that sometimes when we knew the truth, we kept our mouths shut. Because we worried about status. We worried about other people's opinion. We worried about our position. And none of that's going to mean anything. If you die tomorrow, your status, your position will mean nothing. What will have been matter is what did you do for Christ and how did you reflect Christ in your life? And did you do right by others? And how did you treat others? If there was ever a time when we need grace, we need the grace of God, that time is now. Listen to this song and we'll come back and have a word of prayer.
Measured out my days, life carried me along. In my soul, I yearn to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. I looked hard at this world. Just to end where I began, where human effort is all in vain. Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down with my salvation up to me. I know how that would go. The battles I would face, forever running but losing the race, were it not expressed with all my heart, offered to a friend who took my place and ran a course I could not start. And when he saw in full just how much his love would cost, wandering down some path.
brothers and sisters, I want to say that it's been the mercy and grace of God that all of us have been kept to maintain and want to uphold the standard of righteousness and the standard of the great truths of the first, second, and third angels' messages within Adventism, along with Christ, our righteousness. Brothers and sisters, it's time for you to get rooted and grounded intellectually and spiritually, settled into the truth that you cannot be moved. No matter what goes on in the church, you cannot be moved. No matter what goes on in self-supporting circles, you cannot be moved. You know whom and what you believe and why you believe it. And though you see things in here that are so-called, that are great and enormity and then even an apostasy, you must keep your eyes upon Jesus. And if you want to develop your character quickly, then ask God for the burden for souls in service and go and labor for others and bring them in, teaching them everything that you know to be true and teach them how to avoid the foxes, how to avoid the wolves that are in sheep's clothing, even among us. But teach them how to be firm as a rock to the word of God and to the spirit of prophecy. And firm in wanting to and maintaining standards and keeping the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. And how to even stand up against opposition, even if it's when false theology is coming in from the pulpit. Because what's going to happen eventually is only two things going to happen. Either the church will change and call for the old way, wherein was the old past, wherein was the good way, or they will put you out of the church saying, let the Lord be praised. And I'm just telling you, that's the only two places you're going. But you can get put out of the church and not be put out of Christ. We are not Roman Catholics. And you need to remember that too. Even though we got a lot of Catholic theology starting to show up among us. So brothers and sisters, be of good courage and keep your eyes on Jesus. I'm praying God help me keep my eyes on Jesus. Because if it weren't for Jesus, nothing would keep me here. But Jesus has kept me. And I recognize this is his church. I recognize the doctrines that make his church. Not just because it says Seventh-day Adventists, but because of also the doctrines that were given us as a people, not just 27 fundamentals, but especially the first, second, and third angels' messages. And I recognize that we are in a laic condition and we must be partakers of Christ's righteousness because we're blind, we're poor, we're miserable, and we are in need of much and know not that we are in need of much and we are naked. God help us come out of that nakedness. God help us understand his will for our lives. Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, let us not be forever running but losing a race, but grant that we will have the grace of your Holy Spirit. For we, like the Apostle Paul says, for we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. Lord, we need the imputed and imparted righteousness of Christ that we might be partakers of the divine nature and escape the corruptions that are in this world through lust. Lord, we need a revival of the old past, wherein were the good way. We ask thee, Lord, please have mercy and please grant that many of us will have that revival that we so desperately need, that revival that helps us want to go all the way with Jesus, Lord, and have reformation in our lives, changing our diet, changing our behavior, changing what we look at, change what we desire to meditate on. Lord, help us be in this world, but no longer of the world, but help us look and be preparing for the world that is to come. With world without end, a world of immortality, a world where we'll be with Jesus and wing our way to worlds afar. We will follow the Lamb wherever he goeth. Lord, let us be prepared for that world. And let us do all we can to win souls that are in darkness and error that they might see the light shining from the cross of Calvary and see the light shining from Christ's resurrection and high priestly ministry as our great high priest in the most holy place. Oh Lord, please help us to tell the story of a love of a God, of the love of God to save a lost world, to redeem and restore men into the image of God. Help us to spread the light of Christ's righteousness that the earth might be lightened with his glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Brothers and sisters, unfortunately, we'll see y'all on next Friday night and probably and next weekend. But tomorrow, there'll be no service because we have to do a communion service here. But please, go back and study and be ready, be fresh as we're going to finish up the Church of Thyatira on this Friday, because we'll be ready to be going to this, going to the Church of Sardis, and hopefully about being this weekend and the following weekend be in the Church of Sardis. So this weekend, hopefully we'll finish up Church of Thyatira. Brothers and sisters, please go back. Go back and search these things out. God bless you and be faithful to Jesus and keep your eyes on Jesus. And next week, please keep me in prayer because I will be in Colombia, South America again, in Cali, Colombia. So I need you to be praying also that by that time too, we'll have a good signal over there. I think we will have a signal in Cali. All right. Okay, because I'm gonna be there for a prophecy seminar with health and prophecy. All right. God bless you. And so keep me in your prayers. And meantime, God bless you. I love you guys. I love all of love God's people. Please keep us in prayer. And please stay close to Jesus. He's our only hope. He's our only refuge. He's my only refuge. And he's your only refuge. God bless.
And when he saw in full just how much his love would cost, he still went the final mile between me and heaven so I would not be lost. And tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me, and I know how that would go. The battles I
should be, we stay with the truth of God and his word. That's your only safety. Your safety is not in any organization, not here, not over wherever we might be at. Your safety is in the word of God and in the truth of the Bible and the spirit of prophecy combined. And if you're not rooted and grounded in that, you are anchored nowhere. Do you fear God? Do you love God with all your mind, with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength? When Jesus told the people of his day, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy mind, with all thy heart and all thy soul, and with all thy strength, Jesus was saying, fear God. Jesus was preaching the first angel's message.
Fundamental Bible teaching, Daniel Revelation. If we don't believe this, then we ought to throw out Revelation 13. If we don't want to believe this, then we ought to not preach Revelation 17. If we don't want to believe this, then we ought to not be preaching and doing Revelation seminars at all. Nor evangelistic meetings. Because our purpose is not just to preach about the love of Jesus, but it's to preach about his love, his mercy, his work as our high priest, his work in the sanctuary, his coming back again, our getting ready for his coming, and the warnings of Bible prophecy that show us that we are heading for the final scenes of Earth's history, and that we're going into a great time of trouble such as never was since it was a nation, and it's not a myth.
God is showing you is about to come. And it's rising up right in front of us. The sun is about to rise. And God is asking, do you have any oil in your lamp? Is there any water in you? Is there any spirit in you? My spirit, do you have the fruits? Do you have the character? Do you have the burden for souls? Are you willing to give up everything? Lose everything down here for once, for the saving of souls. Because in the end, when all this is said and done, that's what it's about.